The Word became flesh and lived among us.
And we have seen his glory.
In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things came into being through him, and without him, not one thing came into being. What has come into being in him was life, and the life was the light of all people. The light shines in darkness, and the darkness did not overcome it. He was in the world, and the world came into being through him, yet the world did not know him. He came to what was his own, and his own people did not accept him. But to all who received him, who believed in his name, he gave power to become children of God, who were born not of the blood or of the will of the flesh or of the will of man, but of God. And the Word became flesh and lived among us, and we have seen his glory, the glory as of a Father's only Son, full of grace and truth. Let us pray. Almighty God, you have poured upon us the new light of your Word made incarnate. Grant that this light, enkindled in our hearts, may shine forth in our lives. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Thank you.
late evening service. My name is Emily Wilmer, and I'm the rector here at St. John's, and if you are new to us, we are grateful that you are here. Our service can be followed along in your bulletins and in the red Book of Common Prayers and hymnals that are located in your pews. And we thank you for wearing your mask throughout the service and keeping about 3 feet of distance from one another. And during the service, those who will be reading will all be removing their masks, but we'll be putting them on after the service. And then just a little note about the electronic candles. If you see them flickering, you just need to adjust them off and on. They have a tendency to have a mind of their own. So just, you know, turn them off during the service, and then after communion, we'll turn them on for the singing of Silent Night. Let's have a moment of silence as we prepare our hearts for the presence of God. Our service continues in your bulletin. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
And blessed be God's kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. Lessons.
A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who live in a land of deep darkness, on them a light has shined. You have multiplied the nation. You have increased its joy. They rejoice before you with joy as the harvest, as people exult when dividing plunder. For the yoke of their burden and the bar across their shoulders, the rod of their oppressor, you have broken as on the day of Midian. For all the boots of the tramping warriors and all the garments rolled in blood shall be burned as fuel for the fire. For a child has been born to us, a son given to us. Authority rests on his shoulders, and he is named Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. His authority shall grow continually, and there shall be endless peace for the throne of David and his kingdom. He will establish and uphold it with justice and with righteousness from his time onward and forevermore. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will do this. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please join me in reading Psalm 96, found in your service bulletin in unison. Sing to the Lord a new song.
Sing to the Lord, all the whole earth. Sing to the Lord and bless his name. Proclaim the good news of his salvation from day to day. Declare his glory among the nations and his wonders among all peoples. For great is the Lord and greatly to be praised. He is more to be feared than all gods. As for all the gods of the nations, they are
decree went out from the Emperor Augustus that all the world should be registered. This was the first registration and was taken while Quirinius was governor of Syria. All went to their own towns to be registered. Joseph also went from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to the city of David called Bethlehem, because he was descended from the house and family of David. He went to be registered with Mary, to whom he was engaged, and who was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for her to deliver her child, and she gave birth to her firstborn son, and wrapped him in bands of cloth, and laid him in a manger, because there was no place for them in the inn. In that region, there were shepherds living in the fields, keeping watch over their flocks by night. Then an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, for see, I am bringing you good news of great joy for all the people. To you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign for you. You will find a child wrapped in bands of cloth and lying in a manger." And suddenly, there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace among those whom he favors." When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let us go now to Bethlehem and see this thing that has taken place, which the Lord has made known to us." So they went with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the child lying in a manger. When they saw this, they made known what had been told them about this child, and all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds told them. But Mary treasured all these words and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all they had heard and seen, as it had been told them. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
I want to begin tonight's sermon with a poem. It was written by John Shea, and it is called Sharon's Christmas Prayer. She was five, sure of the facts, and recited them with slow solemnity, convinced every word was revelation. She said, They were so poor. They had only peanut butter and jelly sandwiches to eat. And they went a long way from home without getting lost. The lady rode a donkey. The man walked, and the baby was inside the lady. They had to stay in a stable with an ox and an ass. But the three rich men found them because a star lighted the roof. Shepherds came, and you could pet the sheep but not feed them. Then the baby was born. And do you know who he was? Her quarter eyes inflated to silver dollars. The baby was God. And she jumped in the air, whirled around, dove into the sofa, and buried her head under the cushion, which is the only proper response to the good news of the Incarnation. We all know that Christmas is a time for children. Even though we grumble during this time of pandemic as rising COVID infections, staffing shortages, and shipping delays thwart our efforts to get Christmas right, we know, at the bottom of our hearts, that it's really all about the children. All you had to do was be at our family service earlier this evening with the children gathered on the chancel steps, and you would have figured this out. We all know it, even those of us who don't have children, because really, we are all kids. Inside. I want to be like that kid in the poem. I want my eyes to go from quarters to silver dollars when I think about the wonder of that little baby in that manger being God. Because if you think about it, it's an amazing thing. This story we tell about a couple on the road, helpless with no place to stay, so far from home, and with only peanut butter and jelly sandwiches to eat. There are probably a million sermons about how Christmas is for children, and I fear many of them can turn a little sappy and sentimental. It's easy this time of year to head in that direction. But I want to explore what it would be like to truly look at the good news of the Incarnation, the Word made flesh, God born into our lives, from a child's perspective, one that reaches the very core, the very depth of our identity as children of God. A God who, through the Incarnation, became as vulnerable as an infant child. And in doing this, I am, in fact, doing the very thing Jesus asked his followers to do. In the Gospel of Matthew, he says, "Truly I tell you, unless you change and become like children, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. Whoever becomes humble like this child is the greatest." Then in Luke's gospel, there is this passage. But Jesus, aware of their inner thoughts, took a little child and put it by his side, and he said to them, "Whoever welcomes this child in my name welcomes me, and whoever welcomes me welcomes the one who sent me." And finally, again in Matthew, we have Jesus said, "Let the little children come to me, and do not stop them, for it is to such as these that the kingdom of heaven belongs." What is it that Jesus is saying here? He certainly wasn't prone to sappy sentimentality. And when he says to his followers, to all of us, that we must become like children, I don't think he's talking about wide-eyed innocence or ignorance of life's inherent difficulties. I believe he is saying something else entirely. By necessity, as we grow up, something happens. I'm not just talking about a loss of childlike innocence. I'm saying that the world we live in requires us to build a facade, a front that protects us, gives us necessary boundaries. In many ways, we need these false fronts, these masks, as Carl Jung called them, and not COVID masks. We need them to make it through our days in this world, filled with hazards and just plain aggravation. But we, being human as we are, can be prone to take these facades too far, to rely on them and the rules we associate with them too much. We become like the Pharisees. We read about in the Gospels, more concerned with doing things the right way than with engaging the messy magic of our relationships with one another and with God. Our facades are useful tools when we face the world, but they can cause great distance and distress when we let them interfere with those things that are most important to our deepest, inmost selves, our connections to each other and to the God who created us. When Jesus tells us that we must approach life as a child would, he is releasing us from the burden of the false front and giving us the gift of being able to live our lives authentically. He is inviting us to live in the moment with hearts open, unafraid of all those things that we are protecting ourselves from when we build our facades. When my own children were very young, we spent a lot of time at Maymont. And I'll never forget the time my oldest saw people throwing coins into the fountains, into one of the ponds in the Japanese garden for the first time. After explaining to him that they were making a wish, I gave him a coin to toss in so he could make one too. He threw the coin in with great enthusiasm, and I asked him, "What are you wishing for?" And he said, "I wish I was throwing a coin into the fountain." Don't you wish that you could spend your entire lives wishing you were doing exactly what you are doing at any given moment? That is what we call being in the moment. And that is living an authentic life, fully present to now. Hearing the Christmas story stirs the child within us to be free to the present moment and open our hearts hearts God already knows and desires. This is what we affirm tonight when we began our service with the prayer, O God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. When we become more aligned with what our hearts are telling us, and we shed our facades, the protection of the laws that we make for ourselves, the Pharisees within, then we become more aligned with the God who created us and to who we were created to be, more authentic and more receptive to the love that came down on Christmas in the form of a little child. We become more childlike and more able to embrace God's profound, unbounded, unmasked love for us. This is why Christmas is not simply a remembrance of a past historical event. Tonight we relive the incarnation, the birth of God in our own lives. And as we do this, we are reminded of our inherent goodness and belovedness. A goodness that we were somehow far more aware of when we were children. So tonight, when you finally get to bed, after you've gotten all ready for the morning, after you've put together the last toy, or wrap the last present if you're a parent, or after you've had a nightcap if you're a grandparent, or even after you've had a peanut butter and jelly sandwich. When you get into bed and finally rest your head on the pillow, remember the child inside of you and allow yourself to feel the love of God to your very core. Or instead of doing that, you could jump in the air, whirl around, dive under the covers, and bury your head under the pillows. Because that would be, after all, the only proper response to the good news of the Incarnation. Merry Christmas. Amen.
Please join me in the prayers of the people coming in the service.
Please stand or kneel as you are able.
My sisters and brothers, in the peace of God, all the gifts we shall give and receive in these days are but small tokens of the gift that shines forth in God's word made flesh this night. From grateful hearts, let us intercede for all who find themselves longing for this deepest, truest gift, saying, Lord, hear our prayer. Christ, born in the stable, give courage to all who are homeless.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Christ, for whom the angels sorrow of the kingdom to all who weep.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Christ, worshipped by the shepherds, give peace on earth to all who are oppressed.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Christ, before whom the wise men knelt, give humility and wisdom to all who govern.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Christ, whose radiance filled the lowly manger, give the glory of your resurrection to all who rest in you.
Lord, hear our prayer.
I invite the congregation to add their prayers, either silently or aloud. Jesus, child of Mary, you know us and love us. You share our lives and hear our prayers. Lord, we thank you. Amen.
The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
I'll just have a few announcements to make before we continue our service. Welcome again to all of you who are worshiping with us this evening. What a joy it is to be able to gather in person. This time last year, we were live streaming our service from the chancel, just me. So I'm so grateful to be together with you today. And we'd love for you to return for our Lessons and Carols service, which will be held this Sunday at 10 a.m. or any other time throughout the year. We worship currently at 10 a.m. once on Sunday, and as the COVID numbers start declining, we'll resume our regular Sunday worship schedule, 8:15 and 10:30 a.m. But for now, 10 o'clock, and we'd love to have you. Just a few words about communion. All are welcome at Christ's table, and you may come forward to the altar for communion or for a blessing. And if you would like communion to be brought to your pew, just let one of the ushers know and we will do that. And take your time, come up forward as you feel, and at the kind of distance that will make you feel comfortable as we're trying to keep everyone safe and healthy. Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, a perfect self-offering to God.
Thank you.
great Thanksgiving continues in your service bulletins. Please stand as you are able. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, because you gave Jesus Christ, your only Son, to be born for us, who by the mighty power of the Holy Spirit was made perfect man of the flesh of the Virgin Mary, his mother, so that we might be delivered from the bondage of sin and receive power to become your children. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, according to his command, O Father, we remember his death, we proclaim his resurrection, we await his coming in glory. And we offer our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving to you, O Lord of all, presenting to you from your creation this bread and this wine. We pray you, gracious God, to send your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the sacrament of the body of Christ and his blood of the new covenant. Unite us to your Son in his sacrifice, that we may be acceptable through him, being sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, put all things in subjection under your Christ, and bring us to that heavenly country where, with the Blessed Mary, the beloved John, and all your saints, we may enter the everlasting heritage of your sons and daughters through Jesus Christ, our Lord, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church, and the author of our salvation. By him, and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
or kneel as you wish.
Let us pray. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and you have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace, and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart, through Christ our Lord. May Almighty God, who sent his Son to take our nature upon him, bless you in this holy season, scatter the darkness, and brighten your heart with the light of his holiness. Amen. May God, who sent his angels to proclaim the glad news of the Savior's birth, fill you with joy and make you heralds of the gospel.
Amen.
May God, who in the Word made flesh, joined heaven to earth and earth to heaven, give you his peace and favor.
Amen.
And the blessing of God, Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you forever.
Amen.
Amen.